In your previous grade, you must have learned about electrical conductivity in solids. There are good conductors of electricity, weak conductors of electricity, and bad or non-conductors of electricity. Here we'll see how they behave. In this setup, all the connections are there, only one part is missing, and that will tell us about the electrical conductivity of these three materials. Good conductors like copper are materials that easily let electricity flow through them. Let's try it. See, the bulb is nice and bright. Weak conductors allow electricity to pass, but a lot of it is lost during the transfer. The lead from a pencil is a good example of a weak conductor. And you can see the bulb is not as bright. Bad or non-conductors don't allow any electricity to pass, like rubber or plastic. Here the bulb does not glow at all. That's why it's good to wear rubber slippers or shoes when touching any electrical item. In this lesson, we will see that even liquids can be all three types, as they were in solids. They can be good, weak, or poor conductors of electricity. Liquids that conduct electricity are solutions of acids, bases, and salts in water. Solutions of acids can be prepared by adding sulfuric acid or hydrochloric acid or any other acid in water. Vinegar and lemon juice can also be used because vinegar has acetic acid and lemon juice has citric acid. Solutions of bases can be prepared by adding sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide or any other base in water. Solutions of salts can be prepared by adding copper sulfate or sodium chloride, which is common salt, or any other salts in water. Let us also prepare ourselves with some non-conducting liquids. For that, we need distilled water or a sugar solution. Before we do the experiments to actually see the conductivity, you should know a little more things related to electrical conductivity in liquids. Firstly, liquids conduct electricity through themselves in a way that's different from solids. First difference is, in solids, electricity is carried by the electrons through the solid. But in liquids, it is carried by the positively charged and negatively charged ions. For example, in the copper sulfate solution, electricity is carried by the copper ions and sulfate ions. The second difference is, in solids, there is no chemical reaction taking place when electricity is passed through it. In liquids, there is a chemical reaction taking place when electricity passes through it. For example, when electricity passes through water or H2O, a chemical change takes place where the water decomposes into hydrogen and oxygen gases. Secondly, liquids or solutions that conduct electricity are called electrolytes. Therefore, it's obvious that a strong electrolyte means that it's a good conductor of electricity, and that's because it has more ions. These are all strong electrolytes. Sulfuric acid solution, nitric acid solution, sodium hydroxide solution, potassium hydroxide solution, common salt solution, copper sulfate solution, silver nitrate solution, etc. Once again, it's obvious that a weak electrolyte means that it does conduct electricity, but to a lesser extent. It's weaker, and that's because it has lesser number of ions. These are all weak electrolytes. Vinegar, acetic acid solution, lemon juice, which is citric acid solution, ammonium chloride solution, tap water, rain water. Thirdly, to conduct electricity through the liquid, there needs to be two sets of solid electrical conductors that are in contact or dipped in the liquid. These are called electrodes. Since any DC current has a positive and a negative terminal, like all batteries have, the electrode connected to the positive side is called the anode, and the electrode connected to the negative side is called the cathode. The A of anode comes before the C of cathode, and plus comes before minus. So that's how I used to remember it. Lastly, if we have this electrolyte in a container and have these electrodes in place, this whole arrangement is called electrolytic cell. Keep in mind one thing, these electrolytes are not as good conductors of electricity as solids. This means we need more than one electric cell. In fact, we need a battery of cells to pass electric current through the electrolyte to study the chemical effects of electric current. Instead of the battery, we can also use what's called a battery eliminator that can convert alternate current into direct current at the required voltage. Now we know all the parts and factors that we need to consider when we study electrical conductivity in liquids. So here's a nice looking setup, and I'll show you how to make it later in the DIY part of the lesson. Now you can see that this circuit is complete and the light is coming on. Now when I turn this, these two electrodes are not touching each other anymore, and you can see that the light has gone off. And this means now the circuit is broken only from this part. And now what we'll do is we'll dip these electrodes in various solutions to see which ones conduct electricity and how much. And are they strong, weak, or poor conductors of electricity? In some situations, it might be that the bulb doesn't glow because there's not enough current flowing through the circuit to heat the filament of the bulb enough to make it glow. But then there might still be a weak current passing through. To detect the weak current, we can use a very low powered LED. You can see that the LED glows even with this low current passing through the circuit. In fact, the LED looks quite bright actually. Now I'm putting some copper sulfate into the distilled water and let's see the bulb now. With just 6 volts battery, the solution didn't manage to get the torch bulb to light up, but the LED lights up once again. Now let's try with vinegar. Once again, the LED lights up quite well. Now let's put drinking water. The LED is also just about lighting up, but it's not as bright as what it was before. This time I've squeezed 3 limes and I've put an equal amount of water. Let's see how well this solution conducts electricity. Hey, the LED is bright again. Now I've put some sugar into distilled water and dissolved most of it. And you can see the LED is glowing mildly, not too bright. Now it's the turn of distilled water, which is supposed to be a poor conductor. And yes, even the LED doesn't glow. And if this LED also doesn't glow, then we can use a magnetic compass with a decent amount of wire of the circuit wrapped around the compass. If there is a current passing through the wire, it will create a magnetic field and that will disturb the magnetic field of the compass and the needle will get deflected. In these weak conductors of electricity, there is a small deflection that we can see. We can also change the conductivity of a liquid. The distilled water was not conducting electricity, but then we added some salt to it and started stirring it. Let's see what happens. Now there is a weak current passing through it. We can do the same thing by even adding acids to the solution, or we can add a base to the solution, and that will increase the electrical conductivity in a non-conducting liquid. We can even increase the amount of electricity passing through the circuit by increasing the amount of current passing through it. Regular tap water manages to conduct electricity because of the mineral salts dissolved in it, and this is why it's dangerous to touch electric points with wet hands. In fact, even rainwater conducts electricity because when it falls through the air, it reacts with many gases on the way, mainly carbon dioxide, to form a weak carbonic acid. During the rainy seasons, some animals and humans die because they get electrocuted when they touch electric poles, even if they are made of cement. And this happens because the pole is wet with the rain and the wetness can connect the live wire at the top to the point where they are touching it. This is also the same reason why firemen first switch off the electricity of a building on fire before they start throwing water on it. Let me show you an example of this as an experiment. Here the water is flowing out. One electrode is inside the container and the other is on the flowing stream outside. Will it conduct? Well, it does. And it conducts even here when I touch one electrode to the stream and other to the place it's falling onto. This means that if a fireman uses a hose, the electricity could travel all the way up to him through the stream of the water itself. Now let's do a recap and move on to the DIY project. Similar to solids, liquids can also conduct electricity. Liquids can be good, weak, or poor conductors of electricity. Liquids that are good conductors of electricity are solutions of acids, bases, and salts. Weak conductors of electricity are liquids like vinegar, lemon juice, etc. Poor or non-conducting liquids are things like sugar solution and distilled water. Liquids conduct electricity differently from solids. First difference is that in liquids, the electricity is carried by the positively charged and negatively charged ions. And the second difference is, in liquids, there is a chemical change taking place when electricity passes through it. Liquids or solutions that conduct electricity are called electrolytes. A strong electrolyte means that it's a good conductor of electricity. A weak electrolyte means that it's a weak conductor of electricity. To conduct electricity through liquids, there needs to be 2 sets of solid electrical conductors, called electrodes, dipped in the liquid. The electrode connected to the positive side is called the anode. The electrode connected to the negative side is called the cathode. This whole arrangement with the electrolyte and the electrodes is called an electrolytic cell. The current flowing through the electrolytic cell can be best detected by using a filament-based torch bulb. A weaker current can be detected by a very low power LED bulb. The weakest of the currents can be detected by the disturbance of the magnetic field of a compass. Tap water can conduct electricity because it has natural minerals dissolved in it. Rainwater conducts electricity because of reactions with gases when it falls through the air. It is dangerous to touch any electrical point if your hands are wet or even if the place is wet. Firemen first switch off the electricity of a building on fire before they start throwing water on it. Now let us see how to make the nice looking setup that I used in the lesson. And we'll also try to understand other factors that can improve or cause problems to the experiment that you can do with this setup. You need these PVC pipes and joints. All the lengths are given on the screen. All the pipes are of 20 mm diameter. That's about 3/4 of an inch. Now while you see how I'm putting things together, let me tell you that some of these kind of pipes are sold under the name of pipes and some are called tubes. Like when you buy pipes for furniture, you actually are buying tubes. The difference is, when we talk about a pipe, then if I say I need a diameter of 20 millimeters, it means that the inner diameter is 20 millimeters. The thickness of the pipe will add to it. This is because when it comes to pipes, some material has to flow through it. So the inside space is more important. But when it comes to tubes, like in furniture, nothing is flowing inside. So a diameter of 20 millimeter will mean that the outer diameter is 20 millimeters. So that's the difference when you're buying pipes or tubes. So now that our structure looks like a cute little animal, you can glue a pack of 4 AA batteries as shown. 4 AA batteries at 1.5 volts each means now it is a total of 6 volts. We tried with 2 batteries and then even with a 9 volt battery, but we found that the 6 volt battery gives the best results. Be very careful using hot glue. Also in the earlier lesson, I showed how to use a glue stick even if you don't have a glue gun. You could even tape the battery pack instead of using glue. Now we need to glue the filament based torch bulb holder on the smallest piece of PVC pipe as shown. We could have directly glued it on the stand, but then changing it would have been difficult, and later you'll see that we have to change it. The positive terminal of the battery is connected to the positive terminal of the bulb holder. On the other side of the holder, it's connected to the crocodile clip, which is glued to the PVC pipe as shown. The negative of the battery is connected to another clip and glued to the same PVC pipe at a little distance. The distance could be 2.5 to 3 cm between the clips. Make sure you glue only one half of the crocodile clips, otherwise if you glue both sides then it won't open its mouth. But make sure your fingers don't touch the glue or the metal area very close to it, because even the metal gets hot. You could hold it with something else so that your fingers are safe. Put some glue on the back of the structure also to hold the wires so that they don't keep floating around. Now you can clip 2 long iron nails to each of these clips and you are ready to start experimenting. To check if the rest of the connection is fine, connect the nails to each other by another metal piece. There, it's all working. And if it doesn't work, then check the batteries. And if the batteries are fine, then check all the connections. And importantly, the bulb as well, because these filament bulbs keep getting fused. In some liquids that are poor conductors of electricity, the bulb doesn't come on. But since you can see the bubbles in the solution, it means that the current is flowing. For those experiments, you can use LED bulbs to see if the current is passing, because these bulbs take a lot less current than the filament based torch bulbs. But we use these filament based bulbs because they show a much better range of glowing light. The LEDs have a positive and a negative connection too. The longer arm of the LED needs to be connected to the positive of the battery, and don't connect the LED directly to the battery, because if it's a less voltage LED, the 6 volt pack might burn it. When the current is really small and even the LED doesn't come on, then you can also show the current by creating a deflection in the magnetic field of a compass. And this can be done by winding a coated copper wire around a compass around 30-40 times as shown. Remember to remove the coating from the ends of the wire where you will clip it to the circuit, and then attach this instead of the bulb to the circuit. Now I'm sure you can see why we didn't glue the bulb holder directly on the stand. Also note that the deflection will happen only once when the circuit gets completed. So you'll have to disconnect it and connect it once again to show the deflection if you want to do it again. You can also connect the circuit to a battery eliminator if you have one, because then you don't have to waste money on batteries, which anyway you have to keep throwing once they are finished. Now you're armed with all the material and information to test out electrical conductivity in different liquids. Always do these experiments in well-ventilated rooms and do not use acids. Just use safe liquids like juices, vinegar, tap water, distilled water, oils, milks, and other things from the kitchen. Things required for the DIY project. PVC plumbing items, the dimensions were given earlier. 4 pencil batteries and connectors. Filament bulb with holder. Crocodile clips. Iron nails. Metal strips. LED light bulb. Glue gun. You can even do without the glue gun. A mallet, bowl for different solutions, different liquid solutions as mentioned, magnetic compass, double-sided tape, copper wire, sandpaper. That's all for now. In the next lesson, we'll start experimenting with chemical effects of electric currents. It's going to be electrifying, but it's safe. Join me there.